Good morning. Welcome. Great to see you here this morning. I want to welcome everyone who's watching at home on Facebook Live. Those of you who might be checking into the service even later on today or later on in the week, glad that you have chosen to worship with us today. What another glorious day God has blessed us with. How beautiful is the weather. We are just so amazed at how God is watching over us. Just a couple of quick announcements as we get started this morning. One is you can find any information that you need about the service on our website, which is very simply www.jarrettown.church. Jarrettown.church is all you need to know. If you want to check out the bulletin for the week, if you want to go to the online connect card, which we encourage you to do, we would love to know who's here, and that's your way to communicate with us if you have any prayer requests. Any other comments, suggestions, whatever you want to share. Just a reminder, if you're here in the parking lot, in the neighborhood, you can listen to the service on 107.7 on the FM radio. And if you have your car on or using the car radio, it might use a little bit of your battery. So just be aware of that. Reminder that we do have some mission projects that are continuing. One is our mission of the month is the North Hills Food Cupboard, which we actually provide all the volunteers to distribute food there every Thursday morning from 9 to 11. So if you know someone who's in the North Hills area of our township, you can refer them there. We serve anywhere from 25 to 32 families each week with food distribution. And we're collecting cereal and juice this month. And then any financial donations that you would like to make, that helps us buy fresh fruit and vegetables when we're not able to get them from the garden. So enables us to provide those items to our folks there at North Hills. Also, a newer mission project is called Welcome Bread. We're making peanut butter and jelly sandwiches for homeless people in Philadelphia. There is one change, and that change is the day. We need the sandwiches on Tuesdays now, not Wednesdays, Tuesdays. And there'll be two big coolers from Monday afternoon on through Tuesday at around 1 o'clock, where you can drop off your peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. Just make normal peanut butter and jelly. If you want information about that, you can also check out our website. It has all the information. They just want cheap white bread, creamy peanut butter, jelly. Put them together, don't cut them in half, just put them in a little baggie, and we'll make sure they get to the right place so they're distributed to homeless folks. The big announcement for today is that next week, next Sunday, we're going to be changing our time. No longer 11 o'clock, we will be meeting starting next Sunday at 9:30 a.m. here in the parking lot. So we want to make sure that everyone gets that message, spread the word. If you look around and you normally see someone here, you don't see them this morning, make sure they know. We're putting all the publicity out. There's a banner right in front of my platform here. It will be on the signboard at the street, also on Facebook and the website. But next Sunday, 9:30 a.m., and then we anticipate keeping that going all throughout the summer. When we're able to, following appropriate guidelines, we will add an inside worship service, but we're going to keep the outside worship service going. So next Sunday, 9:30 a.m., I'll try to remember to announce that one more time at the end of the service, but we don't want anyone to miss out. But of course, if you do miss out, you can always check it out online and on Facebook. So glad that you're here this morning. What a beautiful day it is to worship, lift our voices in praise, to be reminded of God's love in our lives. We're going to begin our worship this morning with Spirit Song. Thank you. fill your lambs. Let's turn to God in prayer. Loving God, we thank you so much for the opportunities that you give us to worship, to celebrate together. We ask your blessing upon us now, and we pray that our worship might be a blessing to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's join our responsive call to worship. God is good.
All the time.
God is good. Let's beep our horns for Jesus this morning. Now, next week when we change the time, might not be able to do that as early in the service. So we want to not wake up our neighbors if they're sleeping in the morning. But glad to be able to celebrate God's love in our lives in that way. Let's sing together, Glory to God Forever. To God forever. Let's turn to God now for our time of prayer. Loving God, we do thank you so much for all the many ways that you bless us, and we sing glory to you. Thank you for the beauty of your creation. Thank you for the gift of your Son, our Lord and Savior Jesus, who provides for our salvation, but also gives us hope for the future. And Lord, help us to be people of hope, even in the midst of the difficult days that we face, the troubles that we go through in life, the ups and downs that come our way. You always are there loving us, guiding us, helping us to move forward. And so we pray that we would see your light shining in our sometimes dark world. And our prayer is that we would be lights to those around us. And so, Lord, we're thankful that we can come and worship, that we can lift our voices in praise, that we can come to you in prayer knowing that you hear us, that we can turn to your word to learn more about how to live lives that are worthy of our calling, how to make a difference in other people's lives, and to follow through on your call for us to love one another. And Lord, that's our prayer for today. Help us to love one another. Wherever we see racism and injustice, wherever we see oppression, wherever we have those hurtful thoughts in our own minds, Lord. Lord, I confess those times when I have had thoughts that are not worthy of your calling on my life. And I just pray that you would forgive me and provide for the forgiveness that I need. And Lord, we each have things that we need to be forgiven. And we know that you are a God who forgives us and gives us the opportunity to start over again. Help us to pave a new path, Lord. We pray for all of those who are hurting right now, whether it's through injustice, whether it's through the pandemic and the sickness that is still out there. Lord, we pray for your healing. We pray for your hope. We pray that we would have a sense of purpose in our lives, seeking to live faithfully, seeking to be a blessing to you and to others. And Lord, as we gather this morning, we're not without our concerns. We pray today for Jean and for Jim and Lorraine. We lift up to you Linda and Alan and Christy and Leah and Sam. For Linda and Jane and Buzz. For Austin and Deborah and Sue and Lee. Lord, we pray for Elizabeth and Craig and Christy. We pray for Stephanie and Bill. For Diane and Cody and Dave. We pray for Jane and Jean and Molly and Judy. Lord, we lift up to you Lee and Jim and Harvey. We pray for Michael and Nancy, for Earl, for Liz and Jim, for Ty and her family. We pray for the Clingers. Lord, we pray for all of those who are struggling in so many different ways, whether it's through being separated from others, that isolation that we find ourselves in, the loneliness that is spreading, whether it's for folks who are in the midst of having been laid off or losing their jobs, Lord, we pray that they would find the path that you have for them. Lord, we pray for all of those who continue to seek your guidance. And for those who are far away from you, Lord, we pray that they would know that they have a friend in you. And Lord, we just pray for your spirit to work in our lives, work in our community, work in our church, and work in our world. We need to turn to you for guidance, for hope, for blessing. And so, Lord, be with us this week. Whatever comes our way, each way seems to bring something new. Each day is a little different. But whatever comes our way, Lord, help us to be able to face it, knowing that we're not alone, knowing that you love us. Lord, we thank you for all that you do, but especially we thank you for your son, Jesus. We offer this prayer in his name, and we continue with the prayer that Jesus taught his followers to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Let's continue to praise God. We're going to sing Christ for the World We Sing. Thank you. what we say, the world to Christ we bring. That is continuing on God's call to our lives, call on our lives, and Jesus' great commission, go and make disciples. We're going to sing now Desert Song. Praise, we bring joy. We'll declare that God brings us the victory. We turn to the scriptures this morning. We're looking at Matthew's gospel. This time a little bit earlier, last week we looked at the end of Matthew's gospel. This week we're looking at Matthew chapter 9, and just a few verses right at the end of that chapter. Matthew is sharing with us, and he says, Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them, because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field." May our understanding be based on God's blessing in our lives, and may God bless us with a new understanding of his word each and every time we read it. Amen.
Coming closer to the lost and found.
Oh man, healing rain is falling down. Reminds me of the healing rain, if you will, of the Spirit. The Spirit falling down upon us. Today I want to talk about, are we offering the right cup? Carl Boyle, a sales representative, he was returning home from work when he saw a group of children on the corner in his neighborhood selling Kool-Aid. And they had the kind of the normal scratched out sign that said Kool-Aid, 25 cents. And so Carl was intrigued by that. He pulled over to the side of the street there, and a young man came out and asked him if he wanted strawberry or grape Kool-Aid. And so he placed his order, and he gave the boy a dollar to pay for the Kool-Aid. And the boy went back and was getting the Kool-Aid together, and the children were there, and they were thinking, well, yeah, I guess we owe him some change. And so they're going through their little box of coins there, and finally the boy comes back with the change and the Kool-Aid, and you know, he's standing there while Carl's drinking his Kool-Aid. And then he finally asked if Carl was going to be finished drinking soon. And Carl said, you know, I'm just about finished. Why? And the boy said, well, that's the only cup that we have. We need it in order to stay in business. You know, it's hard to be in the Kool-Aid business if you only have one cup, isn't it? And I think that sometimes is true of us as well. Sometimes we make that same mistake in the church. Our theme for this morning is really a theme of evangelism. A lot of people don't like that word so much, but really what it means is just sharing the good news of Jesus. It's one of the four purposes that we have here at Jarrettown: growing, gathering, serving, and sharing. Sharing. How do we share the love of Jesus with others? And the word for that is evangelism. And sometimes I think we tend to think of evangelism as being in a certain cup, a certain style. For instance, you might think of those who are sharing the good news as like the slick televangelists on TV, you know, just asking for money to keep the ministry going. Or maybe you think about, maybe you remember in kind of the olden days, so to speak, the tent revival on the edge of town, when the town would gather and they would have these revival meetings, and there'd be singing and there would be preaching, and then everyone was invited to come forward and make their commitment to Jesus. Or perhaps if you're not that old, you might remember the Billy Graham crusades, or maybe even a preacher on a street corner. If you go down to some parts of the city, you'll see preachers out there on the street corner even today. Or maybe the person handing out little pamphlets that we call tracts to people when there are crowds. In some churches, evangelism became a once-a-year event. It was something specific, a strategy that they would follow in order to try to get the word out to others and introduce people to Jesus. But I think sometimes we limit our vision if we limit our idea of sharing to just one cup. If we just have one cup, we're going to be going out of business. And even worse is the fact that helping a friend or a neighbor find new life in Jesus, it gives us a great spiritual lift when we do that. And we're missing out on that if we decide not to talk to others about our relationship with Jesus. There's nothing better to be able to hear than someone saying to you, my life is better because of you, because of what you did in introducing me to Jesus. And that's what we're talking about today. Christ calls us to be evangelists, to be people who share the good news. Are we those who share the good news with our families, with our friends, with our coworkers, our classmates? And we learn about that from this little Bible passage that we have this morning. It starts by talking about our concern for sharing the good news of Jesus should come because of Christ's compassion. Did you hear that in those verses? The compassion is the only reason that Jesus sends us out to make new disciples. That's the reason for it. In Matthew 9:36, it says, when he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Can you think of a better description of people these days than harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd? And just think of that image for a moment, a flock of sheep kind of milling around there in a sheep pen, confused, maybe stumbling blindly, bumping into each other, because they don't know which way to turn. They don't know which way to turn. You know people like that today who don't know which way to turn? People chasing after dreams that only end in heartaches. People worshiping idols that really can never bring true happiness. Jesus had compassion. Jesus had compassion on the crowds. And I think we need to see that when we reach out to people in Christ's name, it's not because we're trying to get more people on the church rolls or anything like that. It's because we believe that Christ can help them put their lives back together. That Christ can help us pick up the pieces of our broken lives and make us whole again. And so we're called to be those who reach out. And the reason we reach out is because Christ loves people. And because Christ loves people, we're called as well to love people. And how many people today feel unloved, unvalued? I think one of the growing concerns in our society, especially since we've had to be isolated from one another, is that sense of loneliness. That sense of loneliness. We don't have anyone to turn to. We don't have anyone that we can share with. I think it's a major problem. Many young people somehow feel that they don't fit in. People today are hurting. Does anyone care? Christ cares. Christ cares. I think a lot of times today people link themselves to false gods, whether it's power or wealth or physical appearance or approval of others. We have all sorts of things that we focus on, and they become gods to us. But the only God that is sufficient for every circumstance is the God who created us, the God who sent his Son to live in our world, to come and to show us how to live and how to have love and compassion for others. Jesus had compassion on the crowds, and he understood the real tragedy of life is a life of empty values, a life with no direction, a life that's linked to false gods. And what does Matthew tell us? He had compassion on them. And that brings us to why helping people get to know Jesus is so important. Notice that Matthew says he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. But then Jesus turned to his disciples. And what did he say? The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. And that's what Jesus is talking about sharing his love, his compassion, his hope. He's talking about reaching out to other people and bringing them into the family. And that's who we're called to be. Workers in the harvest field. Can you see that the only motivation for what we call sharing, what we call evangelism, is compassion? It's love. We're not a business. You know, our motive is not to be making a profit, not to have a more impressive bottom line. It's not to enhance our pride or anything like that. Our aim is to let other people know about Jesus. To let those who are harassed and hurting, as we're told, get to know that Jesus cares. And so his question is, where are the workers? Where are those who are committed to building up the body of Christ, to be in ministry to the world? And I'm not talking about one of those, you know, holier-than-thou kind of attitudes. I'm talking about caring for people enough to help them get to know who Jesus is, to help them out of their confusion and their loneliness and their fear. Let me give you an example. Catherine Marshall once told about a couple by the name of Mary and Harold. Mary and Harold Breinig. Mary and Harold moved to Chicago. This was many years ago. They didn't have any friends in Chicago, and soon they were lonely. And in their loneliness, they got on each other's nerves. You know, they were becoming irritable and unhappy with each other. And one day while they were reading the Bible, they came across this verse from John's Gospel. I love this verse. It's, "You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you might go and bear fruit, fruit that will last." They read that verse, and they were thinking, gosh, I wonder if that somehow applies to us. It almost became a light penetrating through their darkness. And they realized that maybe they were called to get out of their self-centeredness, to get out of, you know, just thinking about themselves and even feeling sorry for themselves. Maybe they were being called to do something and help someone else out. And they wondered what type of service they could provide in this big city of Chicago. Well, the first person that they ran into after they discovered this verse and had this understanding was a waitress who was waiting on them in the local restaurant. And she apologized for giving them such slow service. But she was new to the area, and she was miserable. And so they invited her to come and visit after work. And the next person they ran into was a widower who they became friends with, and they started just meeting together in their apartment. And soon there were a dozen people meeting once a week for conversation and for prayer. And that meeting, that beginning, modest beginning, developed into something called Adventures in Friendship. And soon lots of people were meeting together in their own places and going and visiting those who were lonely and in shut-ins throughout the area. And there was an interesting byproduct of that ministry, because after a while, Mary and Harold realized that they didn't feel bad anymore. You know, they had changed. Their troubles became less and less. Their lives became full and rich. It had a purpose. Probably Mary and Harold never thought of what they were doing as evangelism. They probably never thought of it as something, a way that they could share the gospel with other people. It didn't fit the cup that they had pictured, the way of doing that. They were just showing compassion, love to people in need, in Jesus' name. Well, that's what evangelism is. That's what love and compassion is. That's what the church is called to be. Jesus had compassion on the crowds, harassed and helpless. They were like sheep without a shepherd. And there were so many of them, just like today. The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. Where are the workers? Where are those who are caring enough to be involved in the lives of others? Where are those who are willing to make a difference, to strengthen families, to help young people get through challenging times, to help those who are down and out as well as those who are up and in? Where are the workers? That's what Jesus is calling you and I to be. Can Jesus count on us to share the good news of his love, to demonstrate that love in the way that we relate to one another, especially in these challenging times? Let's pray. Loving God, we thank you so much, and we just pray that you can count on us to share the love of Christ with others. Lord, help us to be a blessing to you, a blessing to one another. Help us to reach out with the good news of your love. We pray that no one, no matter what stage of life they're in, no matter the color of their skin, no matter their socioeconomic status, you know, wherever they find themselves, Lord, help us not to prejudge. Help us not to have stereotypes. And help us to love one another and love everyone just as Jesus calls us to do. Help us to be your laborers, because the harvest is plentiful. Help us to share your love in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let's sing together our closing song this morning. We have a story to tell to the nations. Thank you. darkness shall turn to dawning, and the dawning to noonday bright. And Christ's great kingdom shall come on earth, the kingdom of love and light. Let's beep our horns for Jesus one more time. Let's pray. Amen. The kingdom of love and light. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and stay with you always. Amen. Amen. Go in peace. We're going to invite you to follow the direction.
Thanks for joining us. If you're online, make a note. Next week we will start at 9:30.
Have a wonderful week.
And if you haven't had a chance to check the online Connect card,
next Sunday, 9:30 a.m.
So let us know you were here, and if you have any prayer requests, you can do that through the online card. Have a great week, everybody.